Welcome, everyone. It's so nice to see you. I think we'll get started as more people join. I'm really grateful for you being here with me tonight. I want to thank you for joining me to celebrate the season. For those of you celebrating, I hope you had a wonderful Hanukkah. I want to wish you a joyful Christmas and a meaningful Kwanzaa, and of course, a very happy new year to each of you. I'm really touched to see each of your faces. I want to keep scrolling and seeing all your names. It's meaningful to have your support and know that I'm working in partnership with you to improve the lives of our neighbors and their families. I hope that each of you are warm and well during what continues to be a challenging time. I hope that you're vaccinated and boosted, you're eligible, and taking time to care for your mental well-being also. So I'm pleased to see my parents in Virginia, and I think I see my aunt and uncle, or I know they're joining soon, in Maryland, and several others from states beyond Massachusetts. It's a silver lining and the necessity of continuing to gather virtually. And I'm glad to see so many of you from the 32nd Middlesex District, the best in the Commonwealth. And we welcome our fellow Bay Staters zooming in from other places, including my mother-in-law and sister-in-law. I'm also really heartened to be joined tonight in person, although in a different room, by Mark, Harrison, Oscar, and Baron. They'll join me when some of the recorded programming goes on. While as a society, we made some real technological advancements, I haven't learned how to mute Oscar, and his life is a continuous run-on sentence. So it's for the betterment that he's not with me at this moment. So we're in the final weeks of 2021, which corresponds with my 21st month as a state representative. And despite the challenges, I've been incredibly proud of the work we're accomplishing together. So before we turn to our program, I just wanted to take a moment to talk about a few of the developments that have happened in the last half of this year. So that includes, of course, this month, the governor signing our $4 billion COVID-19 recovery law. It invests in programs and resources that are so critical for our communities, including our healthcare system, our workforce, and small businesses, housing and food security, environmental infrastructure and climate resiliency, the arts and culture sector, and the public education system. And I was so proud to stand up and speak on the House floor for my inaugural address just a month and a half ago in support of this bill and a particular investment we make in public education. And I know we're going to show a little bit of that speech tonight. We'll soon be turning to the fiscal year 23 budget, as well as attending to the federal infrastructure dollars we've received. So I'll continue to raise your voices into the deliberations regarding how our budgeting reflects what we value as a community. I also was proud to vote in support of the genocide education law this year. It's a bill that I co-sponsored to start the session, and it will require that middle and high school history curricula include information about the history, patterns, and prejudices leading to genocide. In supporting this legislation, I reflected particularly on the history of Mark's family. His great-grandparents lived in Armenia and fled to the United States, each losing a spouse during the genocide and remarrying here when they found themselves in Watertown. Mark's grandmother, who I had the honor of knowing, shared horrible stories passed down from her parents about the atrocities they faced. And I thought of them in taking that vote and also of our children in the future. Another bill that I was so pleased to support and see it enacted into law is our school meals law. It's another bill that I co-sponsored to start the legislative session. It ensures that schools that have a majority of students coming from low-income families enroll in the federal programs that enable all students in that building to receive free breakfast and lunch, eliminating a stigma that otherwise might persist. I think about the school where I taught in Atlanta, it would be covered by this law, and I certainly thought of my seventh grade students when voting to enact this new law. Over the fall, I've also been pleased to testify and advocate in support of a number of my priority bills, including on criminal justice reform, college and high school programs, a student and educator data privacy bill, and blockchain technology and cryptocurrency. On the last, it's been a pleasure launching and co-chairing our new House Blockchain Technology Caucus. And I've been leaning in on the bills in my four committees, particularly as vice chair of the Joint Committee on Elder Affairs. In fact, just last week, Elder Affairs was the topic of my most recent virtual community conversation that included Mel Rosians, Mike Festa, and Dan O'Leary. It was really a great conversation, and I was pleased also to moderate an earlier panel this fall focused on early education and childcare. So two discussions sort of at both ends of the life spectrum, but really critical synergies between the two and alignment around some of the challenges facing those sectors and also some real opportunities at this time. I want to shout out to my legislative fellow, Diana, who's here tonight for her hard work on the Community Conversation series, as well as a Conversations with Kate podcast series that we launched this fall, both of which will continue into 2022. And I'm thrilled to have in the office as well, Julia, who's here tonight as my legislative aide. She's hit the ground running and we're really excited for the work to come. It was also a highlight for me to be out in the community during the warmer months this year and to find ways to innovate, including with some of you, to make community possible, even if distanced. I'm thinking of the Melrose Victorian Fair, where I was thrilled to get to interface with so many neighbors in person and to present a citation from the House to our healthcare heroes at Melrose Wakefield Hospital. I also loved partnering with local elected officials to host a fall festivity. We initially were going to do it outside, but we pivoted pretty easily to a take-home pumpkin decorating kit, and it was really fun to get photos of families around the different neighborhoods enjoying some of the refreshments and kits that we put together for them. I also recall somewhat fondly, mostly fondly, my tour of the Rhode Island wind farms off the coast of Block Island as a member of the Telecommunications, Utilities, and Energy Committee. Of the couple dozen representatives on the boat, only one, as far as I know, got seasick, and you're looking at her. But despite that, it was enjoyable to be in person with my colleagues, some getting to meet them for the first time in person, and to focus on our commitments to addressing the climate crisis in the months to come. On the home front, Harrison received his second vaccine dose this weekend, and he had a successful travel soccer season despite his mother being the assistant coach. Oscar has been thriving in his preschool program and again is never not talking. And our family was able to safely travel to Virginia this year for a really meaningful Thanksgiving. So as we turn to the program, I want to again express my appreciation for your support and partnership. I'm really glad to continue to work with you in 2022. I see a number of elected officials who I'll gladly acknowledge later on. I want to thank all of you for joining me tonight to celebrate community unity and the season. So please enjoy your La Cuchara Cocoa if you've already gotten it, or pick it up later this week. It was my pleasure to get to support a locally owned small business in the district. And stay tuned to see if you might win one of the Raising the Bar door prizes that we'll be giving out. Either way, I'm really thrilled to raise up my friend Abbie, who is a local entrepreneur and fellow third grade mother, who is the founder of this wonderful company. I wanna also thank my musical neighbors and my mother for sharing your talents and your amazing voices with us. And to my local elected partners in Malden, Melrose, and Wakefield for demonstrating your love for poetry. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy the program.
Chair recognizes Representative Lipper-Garabedian from Melrose for her inaugural speech.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and through you to the members. I rise today in support of House Bill 4219, an act relative to the immediate COVID-19 recovery needs. This bill is yet another example of our chamber's thoughtful, deliberative, and compassionate efforts to develop a framework of policies that support our communities and neighbors during the global health pandemic. Our investments today in low-income workers, housing security, our healthcare system, the arts and culture sector, food infrastructure, small businesses, and climate resiliency have the potential to change life trajectories. I would like to speak today specifically to a key investment we propose to make in the public education services for our older special education students. But before I do that, I would like to thank my predecessor, the mayor of Melrose, for his mentorship and guidance as I have undertaken this role, serving the residents of the 32nd Middlesex District, the honor of my lifetime. Thank you to my neighbors in Melrose, Wakefield, and Malden. What an honor to work for you for these last 19 months. Of course, there are others from outside this chamber who I also want to acknowledge. My husband, Mark, has been my steadfast partner after our first chance meeting in the outfield of a kickball game in Atlanta. I'm glad he overlooked my inability to catch the line drive to center field, or otherwise I surely never would have ended up in Massachusetts raising Harrison and Oscar with support from many family members short drives away. And though my parents are farther away geographically, it is surely thanks to them, Bob Lipper and Margaret Eads, that I find myself in this room.
Both were newspaper reporters, and our dinner conversations often included discussions of policy developments at the federal, state, and local levels. I learned early on that the decisions made in this chamber, and chambers others like this one, have immediate real-life impacts for individuals and their families. Finally, I speak today as the daughter of a family full of educators, including my great-grandmother, Jenny Mae Downing Barnes, and great-grandfather, Adrian Monroe Downing, both teachers in small country schools in Delina, Tennessee. My great-aunts, Ruby Eads, a teacher in a rural Virginia two-room school, and Eleanor Barnes Murray, inducted into the Tennessee Teachers Hall of Fame, and my great-uncle, John O. Barnes, a high school agriculture teacher, district representative to the State Teachers Union, and superintendent of schools. I think of their excellence in service in such a noble profession as I rise today to speak in support of House Bill 4219. Among its critical provisions, House Bill 4219 will appropriate $10 million and expand eligibility for special education services to any student who turns 22 during the COVID-19 pandemic. As I, for only the fourth time, take my seat on the House floor, I'm reflecting on these students and on all the desks I've sat behind that have brought me to this moment. In K-12 classrooms in the Richmond City Public Schools, in cramped lecture halls at my state's flagship university, Wahoo Wah, as a teacher in the open concept Atlanta Public School building in the Fourth Ward, blocks from the Ebenezer Baptist Church, looking out across faces of my seventh grade students. And I want to pause here to recognize those students who are now adults older than I was when I was their teacher. They deepened my appreciation for the power of public education and widened my view of the socioeconomic and racial disparities in our country. I also think of my desk more recently across the street on the 14th floor, doing legal and policy work at the Executive Office of Education in service to educators and students across the Commonwealth. In these last 19 months, I fashioned many a makeshift desk, whether standing next to a washing machine or on a porch railing as I tried to oversee remote learning and a now three-year-old roaming the yard. During this time, even as so much of the exterior world was necessarily put on hold and physical spaces were closed, time did not stop for our students. As such, so many students and their families missed rites of passage and communal events celebrating milestones. I have felt for each of them. And I have heard from many parents who share with me concerns about their sons and daughters with special needs as they have neared the end of their eligibility for special education. Under federal and state law, students with disabilities are eligible for K-12 services until they turn 22. Typically, as these students near adulthood, their individual education plans include programming related to the transition to adult life. The pandemic dramatically disrupted the delivery and methodology of these services, limiting access to central programmatic components. Students lost access to in-person internships, vocational education training, life skills opportunities, and tours of adult day programs. One mother shared with me a plan put on hold by COVID for her daughter to learn to navigate the public transportation system, to reach a day program or a place of employment, or simply to enable independent daily life. These transition years are essential to ensuring students have the skills and supports necessary to lead productive lives. But unfortunately, with an eligibility cliff, a student who turned 22 during the pandemic may have been unable to access and participate in this critical programming. Until now, despite the suspension and disruption of programming, these students could not access these services after they hit 22. Thankfully, state discretion and state leadership today exists to extend and fund access to special education services to these students. House Bill 4219 will do just that. The bill before us will empower our older students to continue to access their desks, work with their educators, and progress in their education with additional critical time to compensate for that lost during the pandemic, to put them on a more stable, effective path to the promise of adulthood. I am grateful for the opportunity to speak today for those students. I thank you for your time, and I urge your support of House Bill 4219.
The chair would like to congratulate the lady on her inaugural speech.
Tonight's my first night as a watchdog, and here is Christmas Eve. The children are sleeping all cozy upstairs while I'm guarding the stocking in the tree.
See, the dog is downstairs taking care of the tree.
Yeah.
What's that now? Footsteps on the rooftop? Could it be a cat or a mouse? Who's this down the chimney? A thief with a beard and a big sack for robbing the house?
I'm barking, I'm growling, I'm biting his butt.
Biden his butt. Oh my goodness.
Biden his butt. Yells and he jumps back in his sleigh. I scare the strange horses. They leap in the air. I frighten the whole bunch away.
Now the house is all peaceful and quiet again. The stockings are as safe as can be. Won't the kitties be glad when they wake up tomorrow and see how I've guarded the tree?
That
was a good one.
Yeah.
Happy holidays.
Happy holidays.
Hi, my name is Abbie Romanul, and I am the founder and CEO of Raising the Bar, an alcohol-free cocktail subscription box. I'm going to show you how to make Apple of My Chai, a drink that we had featured in our October box. First, we are going to take our shaker and measure out our ingredients. The first ingredient is a chai concentrate syrup, and we're going to take 2 ounces of that and put it right into our shaker. Then we're going to take 1 ounce of this salted honey shrub, add it to the shaker, as well as 1 ounce of spiced apple syrup. Then we're going to measure out 2 ounces of orange or clementine juice, fresh juice that I've already squeezed here. So 2 ounces of that, as well as an egg white. So an egg white is really great for alcohol-free cocktails because it adds a lot of depth and complexity. And we're gonna add it right there to the shaker. If you don't wanna use an egg white, you can use aquafaba, which is the liquid from a can of chickpeas. Or if you're just not interested in the foaminess, you can actually just mix these things up and then add some sparkling soda water at the end. So before we add our ice, we are going to do what's called a dry shake. So a dry shake is when you shake up your ingredients without any ice in it. And you do that to get a really silky, velvety texture, which you can get from that egg white. So you're gonna shake for about 20 to 30 seconds. When you're done shaking, we're going to add ice. So we've got some ice here. Your shaker, and then you'll shake it again for another 20 to 30 seconds. Okay, once that's all shaken up, we're gonna take our cocktail glass. I like to use a coupe for this one. Take your shaker, and you're gonna strain the contents right into the glass. And once you've finished straining, you can see this kind of beautiful foaminess on top. And then we're going to set a star anise right on top. So that's Apple of My Chai. Cheers. Thank you.
This is my winter song to you. The storm is coming soon. It rolls in from the sea. My voice a beacon in the night. My words will be your light to carry you to me. Is love alive? Is love alive? Is love? They say that things just cannot grow beneath the winter snow, or so I have been told. They say we're buried far, just like a distant star I simply cannot hold. Is love alive? Is love alive? Is love alive? This is my winter song. December never felt so wrong. 'Cause you're not where you belong. Inside my arms. Bum 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 bum. Bum 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 bum. Bum, 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 bum. I still believe in summer days. The seasons always change, and life will find a way. I'll be your harvester of light, and send it out tonight so we can start again. Is love alive? Is love alive? Is love alive? This is my winter song. December never felt so wrong. 'Cause you're not where you belong. Inside my arms. This is my winter song to you. The storm is coming soon. It rolls in from the sea. My love a beacon in the night. My words will be your light to carry you to me. Is love alive? Is love alive? Is love alive? Is love alive? Is love alive?
Thank you.
Now we're going to make a holiday shrub. So a shrub is a drink that is made from apple cider vinegar and fruit and a little bit of sugar. And it's kind of a tart, sweet, wonderfully complex drink, a really great way to add depth and complexity to alcohol-free drinks. So here we're gonna mix up our shrub with a little bit of blueberry simple syrup and top it with some club soda. So super simple, really easy to make, and really interesting and festive. So I already have my glass filled with a large ice sphere. I find when you're making an alcohol-free cocktail, it's always nice to have festive touches like, you know, fun ice or garnishes or nice glassware just to kind of elevate the experience. So what we're going to do is pour about 1.5 ounces of shrub directly into our glass with the ice. And then we're going to put 1/2 ounce of blueberry syrup. And with a bar spoon, just give it a little bit of a stir to mix up the shrub and the syrup. And then we can top it with club soda. And we'll give it one more stir. And you can garnish with a slice of fresh citrus or anything else you might have on hand. Super easy, super simple, and super delicious. Cheers.
Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer had a very shiny nose. And if you ever saw it, you would even say,
it glows.
All of the other reindeer used to laugh and call him names. They never let poor Rudolph join in any reindeer games. Then one foggy Christmas Eve, Santa came to say, Rudolph, with your nose so bright, won't you guide my sleigh tonight? Then how the reindeer loved him, and they shouted out with glee, yippee. Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer, you'll go down in history. You'll go down in history.
Boom. Thanks for all you do, Kate.
Simply have a wonderful Christmas time. Simply have Christmas time. Simply having fun from Christmas time.
That felt pretty good.
That felt pretty good.
Happy holidays from our family to yours.
Christmas went all through the house. Not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. And the stockings were hung by the chimney with care, in hopes that St. Nicholas soon would be there. And the children were nestled all snug in their beds, while visions of sugar plums danced in their heads. And Mom in her kerchief, and I in my cap,
had just settled our brains for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn there arose such a clatter, I sprang from my bed to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters, and threw up the sash. The moon on the breast of the new-fallen snow gave the luster of midday to objects below.
When what do my wondering eyes should appear but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer, with a little old driver so lively and quick. I knew in a moment it must be St. Nick. More rapid than eagles, his coursers they came, and he whistled and shouted and called them by name.
Now Dasher, now Dancer, now Prancer and Vixen, on Comet, on Cupid, on Donner and Blitzen, to the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all, as dry leaves that before the wild hurricane fly, when they meet with an obstacle, mount to the sky.
So up to the housetop the coursers they flew, with a sleigh full of toys, and St. Nicholas too. And then in a twinkling I heard on the roof the prancing and pawing of each little hoof. As I drew in my head and was turning around, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound.
He was dressed all in fur from his head to his foot, and his clothes were all covered in ashes and soot. A bundle of toys he had flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes, how they twinkled! His dimples, how merry! His cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry.
His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and the beard of his chin was as white as the snow. The stump of his pipe he held tight in his teeth, and the smoke, it encircled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly.
He was chubby and plump, a right jolly old elf, and I laughed when I saw him in spite of myself. A wink of his eye and a twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread. He spoke not a word, but went straight to his work and filled all the stockings, then turned with a jerk.
And laying his finger aside of his nose and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to his sleigh, to his team gave a whistle, and away they all flew like the down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim, ere he drove out of sight, "Merry Christmas to all, and to all a good night."
So thank you all so much for joining me for what a lovely presentation and program. It's so meaningful that so many of you contributed. I'm sure you all are glad that I stayed muted that whole time, but Oscar was really enthralled, if you couldn't tell, and he wanted me to say hello to many of you, including his friend Mac and his grandma and Gigi and Bob and all sorts of other folks on tonight. So it's really been meaningful. I'd also like to thank the elected officials who you saw present part of the poem. We're also joined tonight by Malden City Councilor-elect Carrie McDonald. Wakefield Town Councilor Jonathan Chines is here, and I saw Ed Dombrowski earlier. School Committee member in Wakefield, Stephen Ingalls. And then in Melrose, I know I see City Councilor Lila Migliarelli, as well as Councilor Jennifer Grigoritis, and Mayor Broder sends his regards as well. So again, I'm so grateful for your support and to be part of a community with you, and you know, looking forward to warm and wonderful days ahead. I think we'll now pause to hear who are the lucky winners of our Raising the Bar gift boxes kindly donated by Abbie. Oh, am I announcing it, or is, let's see, maybe I am announcing. Let me look back in my notes, and I am thrilled to share that the winners are, Peter Bowman and Lila Migliarelli. Congratulations. You will be getting an above, Raising the Bar gift box from local entrepreneur Abbie Romanul. So, I will now introduce you to our final song of the evening. It's a perfect one to end on. And again, it's so meaningful to know each one of you and to continue to work with you in the years to come. Be well and look forward to seeing you soon. So we'll go to the last song.
Hi there. I'm delighted to sing for Kate's time tonight. Kate, we're really lucky to have you as our state rep. And the song is The Parting Glass by Tommy Makem. Some of you may know it. Oh, all the money that e'er I've had, I spent it in good company. And all the harm that e'er I've done, alas, it was to none but me. and all I've done from want of wit to memory now. I can't recall, so fill to me the parting glass. Good night and joy be with you all. Oh, all the comrades that e'er I've had are sorry for my going away. And all the sweethearts that e'er I've had would wish me one more day to stay. But since it falls unto my lot that I should rise and you should not, I'll gently rise and I'll softly call, good night and joy be with you all.